and the charter accountant also. You know, there is a huge shift that is taking place, a tectonic shift as they call it. In all walks of life, and accounting profession is no exception. But whether the accounting profession is really doing the homework needed to cope up with this tectonic shift has always been a question that has been working in my mind. Because basically I am a chartered accountant and I win my bread only through the accounting profession. In fact, I took a vow when I had to done the role of a writer that I will not make money by writing. I never accepted even 1 rupee by writing. I always felt it was my duty to the society and the country that I should use my skills for a larger purpose, which the accounting profession is incapable of enabling me to do. Each profession has its own range. For example, take the lawyer's profession. There was a time when the lawyers led the freedom movement of India. All leaders are almost lawyers, because that profession's range was too wide. It had 360-degree vision. I'm not saying lawyers today have this, but at that time they had it. You know, this capacity to rise above one's own professional limitations is important not only for the individual professional, but also for the profession itself. But that kind of training is not available in any profession today. And obviously it is not available for the chartered accountants also. There is a structured way of doing things. The chartered accountant means this. But the chartered accountant brain or his competence or his skill sets need not limit him to the accounting horizon. He can do far more. In fact, this has always been a question in my mind. I began to think of being a chartered accountant at a time when the accounting profession was getting into high growth mode. In fact, when I joined the BCom course, there was no great seeker of BCom at that time. In fact, I could get into articles very easily. One of the reasons why I became a chartered accountant was that I could not become a lawyer. Because in Tamil Nadu, nobody would give me admission in the government law college. Because of this reservation and things like that. So my ambition was to become a lawyer. But I had to compromise to become a chartered accountant. But I must confess to you that I became known more as a person with legal acumen than as a person with accounting acumen. It doesn't mean that I don't have the knowledge of accounting or anything, but my own lust for legal knowledge made my clients, my acquaintances feel that I am a much better legal mind and they can tap me for legal ideas, legal strategies, legal interpretations far more than what I could do as a chartered accountant. It's not that I was not engaged as a chartered accountant, but I was used more as a lawyer. So we have this inherent talent in us to transcend our profession. I'll give you a small example as to how a wider knowledge is needed even to practice the accounting profession. It was in the year 1980 when one of my friends wanted some 25 lakh donation for building 10 schools in Kanyakumari district where there was no alternative to the missionary run institutions. So So he came to meet Rama Goenka, and I was the advisor to Rama Goenka at that time. So he wanted Rama Goenka to give 25 lakhs. 25 lakhs was not a small sum. At that time, 25 lakhs was, if it is to be equated to today, it could be maybe 25-30 crores. I mean, I may be wrong, but it is something much more than that. So Rama Goenka said, let me see. And then the next day, Rama Goenka and me were going to Delhi. Goenka told me that Mahesh Yogi, who is the Transcendental Meditation chief, he has a tax problem. Will you be able to help him? I said, I must know what is the tax problem. Then next, he went there and the papers were given to me. And the problem was that he had brought some 25 or 30 crores into a trust in Moradabad, his birthplace. And in the trust, some employees who were his relatives had been engaged. And all of them had been paid remuneration. Some of them were intermediate, some of them BCom. And they were paid salary much more than what the IAS officers would get at that time. So section 13 was invoked and all the trust was denied exemption, the assessments were reopened. And they had put a tax and penalty of some 45 crores and then prosecution. So this was the stage at which they handed over the paper to me. So Rama Goenka asked me, have you got any remedy? We have consulted Nani Palkiwala, we have consulted APC, nobody is giving us any hope. I said, Ramanji, I have an answer. He asked me how. I said, I want, because I have been told by the Kanchi Mahaswami, I should not take money from the trust as my personal income. So whatever fees you decide, he said, I will give you a fee of 25 lakhs. I said, whatever fee you pay, maybe 20 lakhs or 5 lakhs or 10 lakhs, I don't know. I want you to give it to the trust which you wanted to build in their institutions. Then he asked me, you are talking about fees, what is the solution? I said, Ramanji, the solution is very simple. In the Hindu law, a sannyasi has no relative. This is it. This requires a trans-professional knowledge. I had enormous amount of lust for legal knowledge, whether it is constitution, whether it is contract law, whether it is Hindu law, whether it is Islamic law. I had a lust for legal knowledge. You know, that enables you to interpret the income tax law. That enables you to acquire terminologies which will make the person who listens to you, whether he is an income tax official or he is an appellate official, he will think that you have come with a corpus of knowledge. You know, knowledge building is the foundation of a successful company. So then, you know, we got an opinion from Palkiwala himself that the sannyasi has no relative. You know, we got the commissioner to reopen and close the assessments.